Hello everyone. Our next talk is about TLS 1.3 and what you should know as developers. Let's all welcome Daiki.
So, hello everyone. This talk is about TLS 1.3. I'm Daiki Ueno, working in Red Hat Crypt team. So, I think everyone is already familiar with TLS 1.3, but I'll quickly recap. TLS 1.3 is a successor of TLS 1.2, and the final standard was published in last summer. After 4 years of development, it has basically three major improvements: low latency. Oh. So it has basically three major sales points: low latency and more security and cleaner protocol. So low latency, today TLS clients are commodity, and probably most people have smartphones and with web browsers, and also a bunch of applications are talking TLS underneath. On the other hand, the server need to handle a lot of connections, so avoiding unnecessary latency is quite important these days. So in TLS 1.2, to establish the secure communication channel, it required two round trips. In TLS 1.3, it can start with only one round trip. So it makes huge difference in initial connection. So more security. TLS 1.3, while TLS 1.3 brought some modern crypto primitives like EDDSA, it also removed some legacy algorithms which are considered as insecure today. And in particular, all the symmetric ciphers are only used in AAD mode. There are many protocol refactoring, but I pick these two: cipher suites, organization, and session resumption. In TLS 1.2, there are more than Okay, sorry for the instability. In TLS 1.3, there are over 100 of cipher suites defined. That's because a cipher suite consists of four elements: that key exchange algorithm, and cipher algorithm, and MAC algorithm, and hash algorithm. In TLS 1.3, key exchange algorithm was moved to other part of the protocol, and cipher and MAC algorithm are combined into one cipher algorithm thanks to AAD mode. And as a result, the total number of cipher suites is now reduced to 5. And session resumption. In TLS 1.2, the session resumption is mainly done using session ID. So that means the server needs to store the security parameters for the client into a database. And when resuming the connection, the server needs to look up the database. That makes the server stateful. In TLS 1.3, it only allows session resumption with session tickets. That is basically encrypts the security parameters in tickets and pass it to client, and client then send back to the server with the ticket when resuming. So basically, the server uses the clients as an external database. This is not a new idea, and it can be also usable in TLS 1.2, but it also brings some forward security with DHE key exchange when used with TLS 1.3. So TLS 1.3 is all good. So how do I use TLS 1.3? Actually, basically nothing. So major libraries, for example, OpenSSL, GNU/TLS, NSS, all support TLS 1.3 already. But there are actually new features that need to be accessed through new APIs that are post-handshake authentication, key update, and length hiding, and finally, zero RTT mode. So before looking into the detail of the API, so let's think about what is a good API. So some people say usability is the most important factor, and some other people say flexibility is more important. So usability. So usable libraries should be easy to use and hard to misuse. To achieve this goal, one common suggestion is using Huffman coding based on usage patterns. That is to require writing less code for common use cases and require writing more code for uncommon or potentially insecure use cases. So this is about security libraries. So it is also important that default behavior is aligned to safe side. Yeah. And flexibility. So those major libraries don't have any specific target. So it can be run on small devices and also be run on some powerful servers in data center. So basically, those libraries are designed to be flexible using some callbacks or decoupled resource access from the code. And also, TLS 1.3 is not the last version of the TLS. So there will be probably TLS 1.4 in 10 years. So we can't predict the future, but maybe good to not assume some parameters are fixed. But yeah, usually those aspects don't compromise, so we need to find some trade-off. So let's look at the existing design choices. So I pick three factors in those libraries. One is I/O abstraction. That means it has some generic I/O that can be used for both TLS and non-TLS connections. And handshake. Handshake process can be triggered through the manual process, or it can be automatically done through I/O. And resumption data, it can be manually retrieved and restored on same connection, or it can be automatically tracked by the library. So this is basically a summary. This doesn't mean it is good or bad, but OpenSSL and NSS has share similar design principles. That basically means most of the things are automatically done under the hood. But the GNU/TLS is a bit manual, so it requires some code to do some low-level stuff. Okay. So, new APIs. So first, post-handshake authentication. That essentially means the server can request client authentication at any time, even after the handshake. That's in particular useful when it is used with HTTP server. So the server can request client authentication. It is that some resources are really required, so it can delay the authentication. So OpenSSL and GNU TLS provides similar API in the client side to indicate the post-handshake authentication is supported. And server can request post-handshake authentication with the second API. And NSS has not yet implemented, but it is being worked on. And key update. So some cipher, symmetric cipher algorithms have a limit of the amount of data that can be safely encrypted using a single key. It can be requested using a new special handshake message called key update. But it can be sent explicitly, but GNU TLS and NSS implement automatic key updates. So basically, you don't need to do anything. But if you want to send key update manually, all those libraries have similar APIs. And length hiding. So the TLS 1.3 allows some arbitrary length padding to hide the actual length of the plain text. So this is useful if you transfer a series of small files from the server. So that prevents attackers being able to guess what is actually transferred. So in OpenSSL, it can be enabled using two kinds of APIs. That is, first is SSL set block padding that pads the records to multiple of specified block size. And also, for extra flexibility, it provides callback-based padding scheme. With this, you can add really random padding if you want. Yeah. In GNU TLS, they simply added a new send function. It takes path parameter. So this is simple, but it only applies to application data. On the other hand, OpenSSL approach applies to all the messages. So yeah, there are some trade-offs there. And NSS doesn't implement it yet. So, lastly, zero RTT mode. I already mentioned TLS 1.3 handshake is one round trip, basically. But it can send application data even earlier when the client connects to the server in a resuming connection. So that's called zero RTT mode. The sending of the zero RTT data is done in three steps. First, check the maximum amount of data the server would accept and send the data. And finally, check if the server had really accepted it, and if not, the client need to resend the data in one RTT. So OpenSSL is basically like this. So check the limit and send it, and finally check if it is accepted and resend it, if not. And GNU TLS is similar, but it needs to call a handshake function after sending the early data. Yeah. Yeah, NSS is also quite similar, but the point is it uses, it doesn't provide special function to send the early data, but it reuses existing generic PR send function. Okay. Yeah. But on the receiving side of the zero RTT, there are some risks. So because zero RTT data is encrypted using a key directly derived from the previous session, so there is no forward secrecy. And attacker can send the same data if they duplicate the client hello. So all those libraries has a countermeasure to these attacks. And zero RTT, OpenSSL provides using the method called single use tickets, and GNU TLS and NSS use client hello recording. So single use tickets is actually quite powerful idea, and it is ideal if the client use the session ticket only once, but it requires some server-side stuff that tracks issued ticket is stored in the DB and removed once it is used. It makes the server stateful, and even worse, sometimes session tickets are long-lived, so we need to keep the data in the database for a long time. On the other hand, client hello recording is to record the client hello messages in a very short time frame. Typically, it is around 10 seconds. And check if client's views of ticket age and server's views of ticket age has doesn't have any significant gaps. So it can roll over the database every time window is passed. So let's look at the receiving API. It can be done in two steps: enable zero RTT with anti-replay, and accept or reject early data. This is OpenSSL. It's basically nothing to do because single use ticket is already enabled in the first step. And second step, it loops with this special new function, SSL read early data, and then proceed to handshake. This is GNU TLS. It's a bit complicated. It requires manual initialization first, and then set up the anti-replay mechanism with these four functions and set it. And even it requires some callbacks to access the database. And then the early data is sent during the handshake. It needs to be retrieved using callback function. And this is NSS. It uses the same approach, but it is quite simple because it doesn't use database, but uses a Bloom filter that is a data structure used to detect the entry is not in the set reliably. Okay, but it is all in the program memory, so it might not be able to scale to distributed servers. So summary, basically TLS 1.3 is better than TLS 1.2, and TLS 1.3 brings additional features. Some of them need new APIs to access. And as we already see, some API designs may look complicated, but API designs have some reasons behind them. For example, zero-RTT receiving is quite risky, so it requires writing some code is quite a reasonable choice. So don't blame the developers. And there are some resources on the web, so it summarizes approaches. So, yeah, that's it. Thank you.
We have time for two questions. Any questions?
So you showed in your slides that the limit of early application data that you can send somehow has to be configured in the API. Is that a limitation in the protocol? Do client and server negotiate the maximum amount of early data, and why is that?
ZRTT data is only usable in resuming session. So in the initial connection, the server indicates the maximum in the new session.
And why is it limited? I thought that you, in theory, could send as much early data as you want during, as long as the authenticated keys are not established yet.
Sorry, I don't get your question. But,
so it, what's the technical reason to limit the amount?
I'm not sure, actually. Yeah. Sorry.
Any other question? So, thank you, Dagi.
Thank you.